Okay. David Robertson asked a question. How can an FHI officer physically inspect a consignment in Shetland?
We will fly there. We will go there. That's currently what we do at the moment. We travel across the whole country and we will go and inspect consignments from wherever they are coming from, which is why we ask for 5 days' notice to give us a chance to organize and plan. You know, we will try and accommodate visits as short a notice as we possibly can, but obviously there are physical constraints in us getting to some of the remoter areas. So like I say, that's why we do ask for as much notification as possible. It helps us plan the work, but it is what we currently do, so that we will still continue to do that work.
Okay, there's sort of two other questions in relation to this, so I think I'll just stick with them. Anne Mosley asks, how can we notify 5 days in advance when it's not been caught yet?
Well, this is for the FHI, this is only for animals that are going for farming and ornamentals, scientific research, and only for the shellfish that are going, that are not fit for human consumption, that are going for depuration. That's only the areas that the FHI will cover. If the animals are fit for human consumption, that will be the EHOs. So that would have to be discussions with them as to how much notice. And I understand, obviously, if everything has to go through an authorised establishment, I'm not quite sure how they're planning to deal with everything. But, you know, it's... Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, we have to work within the legislation that's there. So if someone is exporting live bivalve mollusks that are from Class B waters and are going to go be depurated, we just appreciate that you'd have to give us as much notice as you possibly can. But obviously the animals will not be allowed entry into the EU if they don't have the required health certificates. But we will accommodate as much as we can. We just ask for 5 days to give us that opportunity to ensure, because we may well already have inspectors in an area or have somebody going up there in the next couple of days, so we can sort out our scheduling for that.
Right. So I think the next question, kind of, you've kind of covered it. It's John Carlos asked if, do we have enough fish health inspectors in Scotland to cope with the expected demand?
Well, we do. We're currently advertising for additional inspectors at the moment. So we are increasing our headcount. And what we have at the moment in terms of what we know of what work is likely to be going on, then we do. But obviously we will have to assess that as things progress. But we are currently recruiting at the moment to increase our headcount.
Right, okay. And there was a couple of specific species questions here, whether it applies to live langoustines, crabs, lobsters, and on a separate question, whelks or gastropods?
For the FHI, that would only be if those animals are for farming or for... I think, am I right, Lou, that the langoustines, crabs and lobsters, that's okay. It doesn't matter what class of water they're from, does it? They would go out with the EHO certificate. If it's for human consumption.
Yeah, so just to point out, so for langoustines, crabs and lobsters, they're actually classed as fishery products in terms of export health certificate. So they're classed as products of animal origin and go through the fisheries EHC.
Yeah, and the gastropods, it would only be, I think that's right, that I don't think they would need to go through depuration. So again, that would be them going out as products with the EHOs instead rather than the inspectorate. It would only be where those animals are going to somewhere for further on growing and farming, really.
Okay, okay, thanks. We have a question here about Vivier Lorries, in particular, how these lorries are approved. So the question said, I'm not sure as a local authority, Officer Vivier Lorries are being approved when they not meet the approval regulations. I'd be interested on how these lorries are being approved.
I don't know if anyone from FSS would like to expand what I'm going to say, but it's up to the local authorities to approve premises, in this case, Vivia trucks. And our understanding is the Vivia trucks have to be undertaking a process that is approvable. So just being a transport lorry isn't an approved process. You need to be undertaking an approvable process on the Vivia trucks. And then it's the local authority decision as to whether that is suitable for approval or not. Hopefully that answers your question. Is there anyone from FSS that would like to expand on that? Take that as a no. Could you indicate if that's a satisfactory answer, and if not, we'll try and find a bit more detail for you after the webinar.
Okay. David Robertson asked another question about Vivier lorries, or a query about Vivier lorries. Says many Vivier lorries operate by picking up consignments on the way. Surely, if properly identified and secured, additional consignments can be collected, provided they also have export health certificates. Let's see, do we have anybody from FSS currently in the call? We can certainly follow up those particular questions. Hannah Fennell asks, when can we expect to find out what export certificates will be needed for these scenarios?
So the export health certificates for exporting, they are already outlined in EU law. So on the slide where I went through them, slide 8 with the different types of fishery products, these are the export health certificates that are laid out in EU law. And what I described was our understanding of when each of these certificates will be required and for which products. So it is possible, and not beyond the realms of mankind, that sort of where I've said, say you might need the live bivalve mollusk certificate, the EU authorities may turn around, it's in their ability to turn around and say, no, it's not the live bivalve mollusk certificate, it's the fisheries product certificate you use. What I've presented is our understanding of when each certificate should and shouldn't be used, and therefore hopefully giving you the best opportunity to provide the right, you know, to fill in the right one, so that when you get to the border control post on the EU side, it's all in order.
Okie dokie, thanks Lou. Leonardo asks, how would it work with a Spanish registered company lorry traveling into the UK with a UK registered trailer to swap with a UK Vivier trailer and then going back out through France and Spain?
Hi, I think we'd like to take that one away. I'd like to check just with transport colleagues, just to make sure the advice that we're giving is accurate. I think I'd like to, we'll take that one away and get back to you. We'll be publishing the Q&A after this session, but I just want to check with some Transport Scotland colleagues on that one.
Fiona, I've just had an email from one of our fisheries officers saying that they've been put on hold. Is that the person that was talking over the webinar previously?
Yeah.
Are you able to bring them back in at all?
Let me have a look. They seem to disappear forever, but carry on, I'll work in the back.
Yeah. Hannah Fennell asks, how much of Scotland's waters are currently unclassified, and will there be a move to classify them? This will have a huge impact on some fleet segments.
So waters are only classified if they are production areas. For scallops, that the waters in the UK aren't classified, and they don't need to be classified because, you know, they're not. Scallops have a sort of derogation about coming from unclassified waters. For LBMs, as I said, it's only production areas that are classified. You can apply to the local authority to have an area, you know, tested and classified. But is there anything specific that is worrying you that you, you know, feel free to unmute yourself just so we can understand a bit more?
Yeah, I'm just worried because obviously a lot of people will just catch scallops live and then they'll go to the final market live, and if all of a sudden we have to try and find ways to process them, that's going to really change the business structures.
Yeah, so for scallops, unfortunately they don't need to come from classified waters, so it's not the actual classification of the water which is creating the barrier to trade, it's the is whether they can be, you know, classified for fit for human consumption. So I guess the options for classifying them fit for human consumption is either through testing, so there are rapid tests that can be done you know, at, you know, when they go through the dispatch center to make sure that they can be exported. It's just that they can't be exported without that additional step, or obviously they can be processed and cooked and shipped in that way. Until that new certificate comes in April with the new animal health regs, if they come in April, you know, that is down to the EU. We can't, that's the sort of indicative date we've got at the moment, but that could be delayed. Then, you know, that there'll be an issue with stuff going live from the quayside. But if you are aware of that, we'd really be keen to hear from you what quantities could be affected, because we've been struggling to find out, you know, just how much scallops go to the EU in that way. Our understanding from sort of larger companies is that it's not an issue for them. So if it is an issue for you, we'd be happy to talk to you a bit more about it.
Okay, thanks.
Michael Cunningham asks a question. Rope grown mussels in Grade A waters go directly from harvest to export and would not pass through a registered food premise. What is the impact of that?
Assuming that the mussels are going for human consumption and are not going for further relaying on laying in the EU, and they're meant for eating. As I say outlined in the principles slide, which I think was slide 11, that the sort of the general requirement is that the product will need to go through an approved premise, which sort of approved premise is up to your business to decide, you know, whether it's a fish market or a processing plant or whatever that approved premise looks like. Unfortunately, the legislation states that it's got to go through an approved premise. So I've outlined sort of, you know, the approved premise could be a Vivia truck, the approved premise could be a fish market, the approved premise could be a processing plant. But if it goes at the moment straight from sort of rope grown to the EU, and then any testing or anything that's done is in the EU to show that it's fit for human consumption, there, as I recognise, there is a challenge in that, and that that trade model may need to change to accommodate the requirements around approved premises.
Is it possible just to follow? So essentially what we would do then in that scenario, as we've got a processing plant in Bells Hill, which wouldn't physically do anything to the consignment, we'd have to trunk that via this site, have it sit here, say that it's been through this processing plant, although no processing is taking place, and then ship it on from here with this as the registered premise. Is that essentially what we would need to do?
I think so, but you would need to check, I say, with the local authority that you don't need to undertake an approved you don't need to undertake any approvable process at that approved premise, if that makes sense.
Yeah, because we wouldn't touch them. Essentially, they would arrive in a filled container and we wouldn't be looking to go further on for processing into human consumption. So we wouldn't be intending to do anything with the product from that perspective.
Yeah, so my understanding is that the product has to go through an approved premise, and at that approved premise, the last, say, stop on the line, if you like, needs to be an approved premise, and at that something needs to be done that makes it approvable. But I think that's a conversation to have with your local authority around what process would need to happen there to be able to pick up the export health certificate at that location, rather than, say, you know, where your mussel farms are.
Okay, no problem. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Question here about LBMs. Do the same import conditions apply for undepurated LBMs coming from the Republic of Ireland?
Yes, that would be, if they were coming in undepurated and they were going to be placed in a depuration facility, they would have to travel with the aquatic animal health certificate instead. Whereas, like you say, anything coming from the Republic of Ireland, if it was already fit for human consumption, that's fine. But yeah, if it's undepurated and going to be placed in a if it's live and going to be placed in a depuration facility before going on for consumption, it would be the aquatic animal health certificate.
Yeah, and you can only use that certificate if it's coming from aquaculture. If it's wild caught,
yeah. Then sorry, I forgot to say that. Yeah,
the same issue would apply, that there isn't an EHC to support that trade into GB.
Lynn McKinnon asks, would testing be required for every batch of scallops exported, or would regular end product testing be sufficient?
I'm afraid that's one we'll take away and speak to Food Standards Scotland about. Thanks.
I think that is me up to date with the chat.
Okay, does anybody else have any questions? I'm struggling going round and round in circles. Have any questions that they'd like to unmute themselves to ask? We've got Kevin joining us, I think, at 11 o'clock. So do we have any further questions before he joins us?
Can I just ask a quick question, please?
Yeah, go ahead.
Whose responsibility is it for putting the approval number on sales through a fish market post-sale? Is it... it's not the fishermen, is it the buyer of the fish? Is it their responsibility?
I don't know the answer to that question on the top of my head.
No, I don't think I do.
My understanding is that the fishermen are responsible up to the first point of sale for 9 pieces of information. Therefore, my understanding is that approval number of the premises then gets attached by the fish buyer. And it's just to clarify that. I've stumped you.
We'll check it. We wouldn't want to be wrong. That sounds right. But we'll check the answer for you, and put it in the Q&A. I wouldn't know how the fishermen wouldn't know the approval number, so no. It would have to come from the first sale buyer, but yeah, we'll check it just to make sure that we've got it right.
And the added complication would be if a fisherman is selling direct to someone in the EU, what's the labeling requirements at that stage?
So at that point, the fisherman is also the exporter, and would need to follow, all the requirements for that. And you would have to follow the EU labelling guidance. FSS have just published the guidance on what the requirements are. So we can make sure there's a link to that, and that gives you examples of what the labelling needs to look like. So, for example, you need to change the labelling requirements. So it's UK now.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
There's another question that's come up in the chat from Sarah. She asked, would importing mussel spat from the EU for aquaculture fall under the aquatic animal health certificate?
Yes, they would do, because they're going on for further ongrowing on a farm. Yeah, that would be the aquatic animal health certificate. So it's basically the same as what would be required at the moment. It's just that the certificate will change slightly, but it's the same as currently required.
Okay, do we have any further questions?
Could I ask one? I'd actually asked it on the chat. I think it's been overlooked. With registering of the Vivier lorries, is it just the trailer that needs to be registered, or is it the whole rig? Because I'm thinking in terms of the number of trailers that are shipped across and then picked up by another tractor at the other end. And, you know, it's a two-way journey often with these trailers.
Yes, I know that the trailers have to be registered separately to the rest of the rig. So, yeah, I think it will be based on the trailer. But again, we'll check with Transport Scotland just to make sure. I mean, the guidance around Vivier lorries is I think it's quite patchy, because some local authorities have taken to approving them, whereas others haven't. So I know the UK government are currently looking at this issue as well, and they're looking at whether we could have some guidance and some, you know, consistent approach to taking about Vivier trucks. So, you know, we'll come back to you with some further information. But yeah, I think it's the trailer that would need to be, you know, registered separately.
Thank you. Because I obviously appreciate
trailers, the trailers obviously get swapped around with different rigs.
Yeah, I appreciate that, because at the end of the day, what we're talking about is, you know, exporting and importing of live fish. And so the Vivier truck is absolutely the crux of the matter. So this is, you know, of key importance. And also the other issue as well is the fast tracking of the Vivier lorries, because of these massive car parks they're building down south to, you know, accommodate the tailback of vehicles and their checks going into the EU with live shellfish and live fish. We can't afford a minute's delay that's not entirely necessary.
Yeah, so my understanding is that Vivier lorries will be able to use the sort of prioritisation service that the UK government are setting up if they're using the short straits crossing. But it's really important that you make sure that the BCP accepts the product that you've got on the lorry.
Thank you.
Kevin Shakespeare, have you managed to join us?
Can't see him on the participant list.
Okay.
Hiding in a phone number.
Ben, have you had confirmation that he'll be attending today?
He did say to me he was, but I'm getting in touch with him now.
Okay, does anybody else have any other questions that they'd like to ask? Or is anything that you would be helpful in terms of guidance that you think is missing at the moment?
Hi, sorry, this is Leonardo here speaking. I have a question about approved Vivier trailers. Let's say that one trailer has been approved by a local authority, from Shetland, for example. Can that Vivier trailer go and collect from a different area where it hasn't been approved?
That's an interesting question. I think we need to get Food Standards Scotland to answer that. So if they're approved in one area from one local authority, I mean, I'm assuming if it's an approved premise, you know, from one local authority, it remains an approved premise. I think that's one we'd want to check. It's quite clear that, you know, we need to get some clearer guidance around Vivier trucks that gives out some consistent messages. So we'll make that a priority after this call. I think someone has a question about the Kent access permits. So the UK government are setting up a new scheme, a sort of check your trailer scheme that you need to be able, that you can apply for. We'll make sure that we put the link to that in the presentation slides, so you'll be able to follow the link to where the guidance is on that. So basically that system will check, you've got to have an amber or green to make sure that your trailer has all the information that it should have with it before they'll actually allow it to go through. The check your trailer scheme, will basically make sure that each trailer has all the documentation it needs to be able to progress, so it won't get turned around when it gets to France. So yeah, you'll be able to access the slides and the recordings and the Q&A, which we'll make sure that we get all the answers to the questions we've not been able to answer to live just now. We'll get them all checked and we'll get them uploaded. Fiona, are they being hosted on the Seafish website?
I'll send them over to you because I've recorded this question and answer bit. I didn't record the slide bit because it's quite a big file. And I'll save all the chat box as well. And
okay, that's fine. So we'll put them on the Marine Scotland website and you'll be able to get them there, and we can send a link to, so if you've registered for this, if we've got your email address, we'll send links around to those materials after the session. Ben, have you heard anything from Kevin?
Hi, Lucy. I've been trying to phone his mobile and his office number. I'm not getting through to him, so I'm not sure what the holdup is here. It may be best just to...
Yeah, so that's fine. So apologies. It doesn't look like we've got Kevin here to answer any customs questions. But if you do have any questions relating to customs, please get in touch with us and we can add them to the Q&A and get some answers for you. We're also having another session, which focuses on moving goods under the Northern Ireland Protocol, which is on the 2nd of December at the same time from 10 to 11:30. And I think Kevin, we've got him down for that session. And I think Fiona was trying to organise a session bit more generally on customs processes. So there should be another opportunity to ask your customs questions.
Yes, we've got a full session dedicated to customs and trade support service. And in the next couple of weeks, I'm talking to Kevin today and fixing a date with him, but it'll be in the next couple of weeks and I'll send it to you and you can send it around to everybody on this call as well.
Yeah, that's great. So does anybody have any last questions before we sign off for today? Okay, thanks. I don't see any other questions coming up other than just to be about the slides. And yes, we'll make sure that the other slides from the other webinar are also shared. And we'll get them put onto the website as quickly as we can. But if that's all, thanks very much, everybody, for your time today. If you've got any questions, please don't hesitate to get in contact with us personally. Thanks very much.
Cheers. Bye.